Mercenaries are the bread and butter of Mordheim. Cult of the Possessed is probably the polar opposite of mercenaries. The Sisters of Sigmar are an order of warrior priestesses.
What do you do with witches? And what do you burn apart from witches?
More witches!
The witch hunters have basically the same goal as the Sisters. In fact, the witch hunters see the Sisters as basically their mortal enemy. For they're suspicious of the true reason why the she heretics are hoarding Weirdstone for themselves. Witch hunters will view every transgression as heresy, and anyone who they find suspicious will be killed. Those who are not killed are tortured until death or confession, both of which will result in them being killed. Witch hunter heroes have some fairly mediocre profiles, but their captain and witch hunters have hatred of spellcasters, which lets them reroll hits versus wizards. The warrior priest has access to prayers of Sigmar, just like the matriarch. While the heroes might be a bit lackluster, it's the henchmen that are the real stars of the show. The witch hunter henchmen are some of the best henchmen in the game by far. Flagellants are immune to fear and start out with 4 strength, making them very strong in close combat. Zealots are pretty weak, to be honest, but they can be used to fill out the warband if you're missing some numbers, or if you want to stack a few more bows. The Warhounds are probably the best valued henchmen in the game by far. For a measly 15 gold, you get a warrior with strength 4 and 6 inches of movement. I always recommend having a full squad of 5 Warhounds at all times, only replacing them for more flagellants as you go. The major downside to the Witch Hunters is their size. Because they have some strong units, they're limited to just 12 models. This is actually the smallest warband in the game, and you can easily max out your warband upon creation. This is why I would always recommend saving up early in your campaign for a halfling. That way you can bump your number up to 13 and maybe get an extra warhound or something. You could also save up for a halfling cookbook in your campaign, which will bump that number up by 1 again, increasing it to 14, which will let you fit in another zealot or whatever you want. For ranged weapons, your heroes are limited to crossbows, pistols, and the exclusive crossbow pistol, which means they won't be the most mobile shooters if you want to go that route. But after a few advances, your witch hunters can become some pretty decent shooters. Overall, the Witch Hunter Warband is a pretty great warband if you want to try a good mix of shooting and strong melee fighting, all wrapped up in a theme of paranoid religious fanaticism. And to be fair, there's plenty to be paranoid about in Mordheim.
Bring out your dead! Bring out your dead!
The undead are your resident horror representatives in Mordheim. Under the command of Vlad von Karstein, the undead ruler of Sylvania, the undead are a horrifying mix of corpses and murderers looking to secure Weirdstone for their horrible master. Undead is a terrifying warband to go up against. Their heroes are a mix of powerful and nearly useless units. The leader of an undead warband is the vampire, and it's the strongest starting hero in the game. It's fast, strong, durable, and it can really dish out a beating. This also makes him very expensive, so you're definitely paying for that extra power. The necromancer has access to necromancy spells. Duh. These spells offer great utility in the form of faster movement for certain warriors, raising zombies to join your ranks, and even draining life from your foes. The dregs, however, are pretty weak. They have similar starting stats to mercenary youngbloods, but they make up a majority of your heroes in a starting warband. You're probably better off keeping them alive for exploration until they get a few more advances than you are sticking them out in the front lines. Ghouls are decent henchmen for the price, since you don't have to worry about giving them equipment. They have 2 attacks and a toughness of 4, which makes them surprisingly durable. They also cause fear. Direwolves are pricey, but extremely strong. Despite their inability to run, their 9-inch movement makes them faster than most warriors, and gives them a ridiculous 18-inch charge range. Combine this with the fact that they get 2 attacks when charging, and they have a strength of 4, it's clear that they are powerful frontline blitzers. Zombies are pretty useless. They're less 28 days later and more Dawn of the Dead zombies. They can't run, they're lousy fighters, and they have the lowest initiative in the game. However, they're cheap, so losing them won't cost you an arm and a leg. When I build my warband, I rarely take zombies. This guy isn't even fully painted. I usually like to take ghouls over zombies. However, as I mentioned, they're so cheap that it's easy to stack up zombies and create your own horde to surround your heroes with, provide defense, and to eat charges. Zombies, ghouls, and your vampire all have the most powerful tool in your arsenal, fear. If you charge an enemy, or if that enemy wants to charge you, they have to make a leadership test. In my experience, a surprising amount of these tests will be failure, meaning that the enemy will fail to charge you, or they'll have a hard time landing hits against you. Fear is a powerful trait that's reserved for very few models in the game, such as the Possessed and Occult Warband. If your vampire dies, your necromancer becomes the leader of the warband. He can then hire a new vampire once he's able to afford one. Normally, when a leader dies, you're unable to hire one, but the necromancer is actually able to hire a new vampire. That new vampire then assumes leadership. However, if both your necromancer and your vampire are killed, then the warband crumbles into a pile of bones, which means they're completely scrapped. So you'll just have to be careful not to let that happen. Overall, the undead are a powerful melee warband with some fun magic and fear as their greatest ally.
Wesley, what about the RUSs?
Rodents of unusual size? I don't think they exist.
The final warband in the rulebook is perhaps the greatest threat to the Empire, far greater than undead or possessed cultists. The Skaven are mutant ratmen that live underground in a vast empire of their own. The only thing preventing them from completely taking over the world is their inability to quash their own infighting. True to form, the Skaven Warband is full of fast-moving units who excel at swarming and overwhelming their opponents. All Skaven have a higher than average movement and initiative, but their lower leadership makes them a bit cowardly. Their leader, the Assassin Adept, is a strong melee fighter and a decent shooter, with fours in both weapon skill and ballistic skill. Not to mention, he can pierce through armor and has a strength of four, meaning that basically any armor is going to be useless against him. The Black Skaven are almost identical to the Assassin. They make for great ambushers with very high speed. The Eshin Sorcerer has access to Magic of the Horned Rat, which has some seriously powerful spells. They can summon rats, shoot warp lightning, and even deal automatic hits to their enemies. Nightrunners are not as strong, but they're cheap, fast, and have an average ballistic skill and strength. This makes them great at zipping around the board to secure objectives, finding sniping spots, or picking off weaker targets. For henchmen, the first option is Verminkin. They're basically on par with most mercenary henchmen, but they have a faster movement. Giant rats are another option. They're basically cheap filler units that can be used to eat charges or hold enemies in place. Very useful in certain situations. Finally, we have the Rat Ogre, which I'm ashamed to say mine is not painted. Mainly for the fact that I've never been able to afford one. The Rat Ogre is a ridiculously expensive but powerful warrior. 3 attacks, strength of 5, and 3 wounds, and it causes fear. No wonder it costs 210 gold. If you buy this one at the start of your warband, it'll eat up a huge portion of your gold, which will hinder the rest of your purchases. But you'll be hard-pressed to find a warrior that can stand toe-to-toe with it. Skaven have their own special equipment options and skills that are all about sneaking and killing quickly. On top of this, the Skaven Warband limit is a massive 20 models, which is higher than the usual 15. So if you want to play a swarm of murderous rat-faced killers, then Skaven is definitely the one for you. Also, High Executioner Veskit, their Dramatis persona, is one of the coolest models ever made, and he's an absolute terror on the battlefield, so saving up for him is a pretty good idea too. So that's it. That's all the warbands from the rulebook. Thanks for watching and... oh wait, I promised you another warband. Alright, well, I'll share one more. One that you definitely won't find in the rulebook.
Send in the clowns.
The Carnival of Chaos is a warband that was added in the Empire in Flames supplement. It's a twisted and pestilent cult of Nurgle worshippers posing as a traveling band of performers. With their foul diseases and demonic magics, they spread plague and recruit new followers who are attracted by the festivities. The leader of their warband is the Carnival Master. He's a sorcerer of Nurgle with access to all manner of foul magic. Some of the rituals of Nurgle are ridiculously powerful spells. Carnival Master is a serious threat to any warband within eyeshot, but the power doesn't stop there. The Brutes, in my opinion, are the linchpin of this warband. These beefy brawlers are packing 4 strength, 4 toughness, 2 attacks, and they start with a strongman skill. This means that if you give them double-handed weapons, like this barbell and his innards, they attack with a whopping strength of 6, keep these guys alive at all costs, and get them into melee to watch the enemy dissolve. Your final heroes, the Tainted Ones, are average fighters, but you must give them at least one Blessing of Nurgle, which are kind of like mutations from the Possessed Warband. These blessings are powerful boons that offer new abilities or traits to your Tainted Ones, such as making them harder to hit, letting them take more damage, or even pass diseases onto their enemies. Henchmen for the Carnival of Chaos are pretty interesting. You have your standard Brethren, which are average fighters who could be given either melee or some ranged weapons, but this warband has access to some demons in the form of Nurglings and Plague Bearers. Nurglings are cheap, annoying little buggers that are great for sticking on the front line to intercept charges and make it harder for your enemies to land blows, as they have the Cloud of Flies trait. Plague Bearers are a bit pricey, but their high toughness and natural armor makes it hard to kill. Plus, they can spew vomit onto their enemies, which is just kind of awesome. You can only have two of them at a time, but they're definitely worth the money. Both of the demonic henchmen types are subject to what's called demonic instability, meaning there's a higher chance that they die if they're taken out. It also means that if your warband routs during a fight, there's a chance that the demons just leave entirely. Fickle creatures, demons. Finally, we have the Plague Cart. Empire and Flames introduced rules for vehicles, and the Carnival of Chaos was given their very own option. The Plague Cart is an expensive transport that can be loaded with warriors. It also increases the warband limit from 15 to 17, which is pretty nice. It also counts as one of those units itself, but you'll still be able to take on one additional warrior. It also makes your demons more stable, so you're less likely to lose your Nurglings or your Plague Bearers if things start to go south. All this stuff makes Carnival of Chaos a powerful and extremely durable warband. If you want to shrug off damage while dishing out some serious blows and cause enemies to puke just from being near you, join the Carnival of Chaos. There are many other warbands besides those presented in the rulebook. Mordheim.net has a complete list. All the warbands I've gone over today are graded on Mordheim as 1A, meaning they are official warbands that are supported by the designers of the game. Anything below that, and you start entering into unofficial or experimental stuff. Some of them are really good, and some of them are of varying qualities. I say stick to 1A until you've had your fill and things start getting stale, unless there's something of a lower grade that really tickles your fancy. Personally, I've never played outside of 1A, and I still feel like I've only scratched the surface. So I hope I gave you a good idea of what each of these warbands has to offer, and I hope I made it easier for you to pick one that you like. I won't say there's a clear winner among them, as they all have their strengths and weaknesses, and the D6 will quickly disprove any hypothesis you might have about metagaming or min-maxing. I don't think it's a coincidence that it's called a die. Pick the warband that supports your preferred playstyle, and that has a theme or lore that speaks to you. This is a campaign game, and you may be playing your warband for dozens of games. Just make sure that it's one that you like, and remember that in some cases, style trumps statistics and fun trumps fairness. Balance is an illusion, we're all doomed to die, so have fun with your friends and play more Mordheim. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have fun.